clap, clap, bitches clap, snap, bitches snap, snap. I'm calling out legends, patrons, and stars. I wanna see legends, patrons, and stars. Hit the floor, girl.
Stars and the secrets and the legends called. Jack's turning his suit all out war.
Cause here I come.
Everybody wanna be a superstar, riding around in a rental car.
I wanna see runway, I wanna see old way, I wanna see new way, I wanna see you play.
Eating the runway, serving the runway, marching the runway, eat that runway. Eating the runway, serving the runway, marching the runway, eat that runway, walk.
Give me a hug, leave it out on the floor.
Why, hello! How are you doing today, Mr. Eric?
Good. Another day here in the Corona life. How are you, Mr. Durante?
You know, just sitting here, just doing a little hair, a little bit of jewel, having just, you know, a couple little... I'm actually not having a cocktail today, which is surprising.
Ooh.
The fact of the matter that I think I'm potentially going back to work on Friday.
That's kind of exciting. And it's scary.
Scary as fuck. Scary.
Yeah.
Scary. Like, I don't know if I'm ready for this. You know, everybody is sitting there and they're like, you know, are we ready? And I'm like, apparently, like, literally, I have 25 messages from clients right now that are just sitting in my mailbox saying, I need an appointment. Okay, girl. Well,
no. This is really booming, that's for sure.
Well, apparently, what I think Governor Rick Scott, no, what the hell, not Rick Scott,
DeSantis,
Ron DeSantis. Rick Scott was last time, right? Yeah, Ron DeSantis is going to be making some announcement today about all of things of how we're reopening.
Yeah.
And the other sad thing about us reopening is that Dan has to go home. Because he's been working from home from, 6 weeks ago? Which means that I'm not going to get laid as much as I have been, which kind of saddens me a little bit, you know? So, yeah. So, how have you been?
Crazy. So, the interesting part for us at Crew Health is that the reality is that coronavirus, surprise, has not stopped anyone from having sex. So... Chlamydia, gonorrhea, every day.
Bitch. Well, but doesn't that take a hot minute to show up anyways?
True. So I'm wondering if this was at the beginning of our corona. So that means we'll have a second wave of STDs after we go back to work again.
I mean, what is a chlamydia today? It's just a, right. It's just a pill. It's just a pill.
Yeah, chlamydia by itself is a pill. But usually we treat them together. So it's chlamydia, gonorrhea. So it's a pill and a shot. Kissing the tissue on the way out with an
invention. Exactly. So let's say hello to a couple people that are in the room. We have Michelle Bone Woods, the owner of the National Bearded Empress System. Hello, Miss Michelle Bone Woods. We have Brad Athan, our fellow follower. He has not missed a show. We have Brad and Thomas, I believe, are both in here. We have London Dumour. Hello, London. Hello. And I see that Chad Abbott, Julius of Fat Marker is in the house. We just love Fat Marker so much. And, you know, his shirt, what was his name that won the shirt last week? He was fantastic. He was fabulous.
I can't remember. It was like the Rent soundtrack in my head, though.
I know. I can't. Well, his shirt has been shipped, and he should be receiving, I think, Wednesday. So,
and the condoms from last week are also shipped, by the way.
The condoms are shipped. And then also he should be also go. Jenna won the condoms. And then, oh my God, why can't I? And the only reason why I remember Jenna's name is because that's my cousin. But I can't remember, oh my God, who was the winner's name last week? It's sitting in the top of my head.
The tacos, the fluffy tacos from Itzayana, from Nevada.
Yeah, tacos and the shirt. He won the tacos.
Bobby from Nevada.
Bobby Z. Thank you, Julius. Hello, Josh Ryan. I see you. Hello, Brad Reed. What's the tea today? The tea today, honey, is they have a pretty face.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, how many times How many times would you say that you have been hit with that in the sense of, I'm really attracted to this person, but they're a little overweight, or, oh, they're a little too feminine, or even, hey, they're a little too masculine. Who knows?
So here's an interesting story. It actually happens to be the quite the opposite in the bear community sometimes. So it's interesting that people tell me, oh, I'm very attractive, but I'm not big enough for them, or I'm not hairy enough for them. There's always like, but blank. Do I need to like drive you by McDonald's to kind of like encourage something here?
Right. So, you know, like, has that happened to you to where they've been like, oh, you're really attractive, but you're not?
And don't get me wrong. I appreciate the sincerity and honesty because I definitely don't want anyone to do something they don't want to do. I want them to be interested in me sincerely, but at the same time, that was that one thing is stopping me. Come on.
So my story about this is basically, so when I was single and I was on the apps and everything like that, I had so many people, and I'm not sitting here being like, you know, oh, look, I'm hot, sexy, I was a piece, you know, piece back then, because she's gained a little weight these days and she doesn't go to the gym as much as she used to, which is going to change because I've got to get this weight off because we have a pageant.
Do you think the gym will open?
What?
Do you think the gym are going to be open when things reopen?
The gym I would have never anybody there. So I'll just bring in my bleach and spray down. But the biggest thing that I heard was, oh, damn, you're hot. I want to slam you. I want you to slam me, blah, 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 blah. And they're like, why do you look so familiar? I'm like, well, I'm, you know, I perform. And they're like, what do you mean you perform? And I'm like, well, you know, I'm Beyonce. Gone. Gone. Bitches are gone. Because they're like, oh, like, and here's the thing. Is, and I'm not saying that this is totally just about the bear community, but essentially I am a bear, so that's, you know, where I identify as, is they were like, well, you know, I'm really into mask for mask. First off, for you saying that, you're a fucking dick, you're an ass. But second of all, I'm like, honey, let me tell you right now, when this hair comes down, the nails come off, the body strips down, I will basically slam you so hard that your mother will have to rebirth you, okay? Like, let's just talk about a couple things here, because that is one thing that I hate, you know, and I used to get also, you know, you would be really cute if you lost a little bit of weight. And I'm like, bitch.
Then make the investment.
What kind of stature is underneath here? Now, I will say now that I'm 41, I need to lose a little bit of weight so I can keep my dick a little harder, but a little bit longer, but, you know.
That's a pill for that.
There's a pill for that somewhere. But today we have a stunning cast. We are guestless. We have amazing people throughout the entire community. The legendary, just DJ. We adult. I hate saying porn because whenever you say the word porn, to me, people think nasty. To me, it's adult entertainment. Director Shishi LaRue. We have these stunning, tantalizing, amazing bitch. If you have ever met this person, you will know exactly what I'm talking about because she can put her legs in every position that you want to. The stunning Christina, aka Faith Taylor. We have somebody that I recently met, you met as well. And when I first met her, it was actually at a club in St. Pete, and this was Enigma. And you know, my aesthetic of drag is not always welcomed, especially from the pageant world, if you would say. You know, they're very like, oh, you're, you know, you're not taking into consideration, you know, our past drag. But this entertainer, this human, this soul looked at me across the room and was like, I love your face. And somebody else was performing, so I didn't want to be rude and get up. So when it was over, I walked over and I was like, hi. I was like, I'm sorry, what was it? And she was like, I love your face. She's like, your paint is perfection. I was like, thank you so much. I don't think so, but the fact that you said that, it is dark in here, so thank you so much. And that is JC Ray, AKA Crystal Michaels. This person I have met a few times in person and have had lengthy conversations. A beautiful, beautiful, beautiful soul. And then we have this luxurious entertainer who's dumb as a box of rocks and doesn't understand any type of direction that you tell her. When we bring her on, you'll see what I mean. Has a current cooking show. It's called Cooking with Eartha.
I'm excited for that. I got to go
living for it. Living for it all. A bearded entertainer, a beauty, a fashion. She just threw on a little something really quick to come onto the show. And that is going to be Eartha Quigg, a.k.a. Luke Jarman. So we don't want to keep everybody held up. So the first amazing person that we are going to bring in is going to be Shishi LaRue. And she is going to be talking about her story. And, you know, Eric, I think on before we bring her in really quick, on your end, like on your scientific side, how important is it for people to not be judging and feel whole of themselves?
Yeah, so oftentimes we live within our two to the space between our two ears. So we know what's going on in our mind, but the people around us have no idea what's going on in our minds. We could be, just to give you an example, today I asked my husband, hey, you know, that person we work with in that building, I wonder what they think of me. So mind you, I've had all these ideas running through my mind. They have no clue. The world around us has no idea.
Yeah.
So we kind of have to be our true self and appreciate our true self because that's where our most authentic life can come from.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, what are we doing other than wasting life, right? And no one has time for that.
Exactly. And this is my authentic life. I mean, I wake up just like this every single day. Flawless. Hello, hello, hello. Right? So, but yeah, you know, nobody knows exactly who, what anybody's going through. So the best thing to do is to not judge them and until you hear their story. And then still don't even judge them because it was their story.
And in fact, maybe it's better to just invest a few minutes to find out a little bit about their story.
Exactly.
Kind of what we're doing today.
Exactly. So if I could get everybody to give the next entertainer a bunch of hearts, a bunch of hearts. So down at the bottom of your screen, there's the hearts. Give it a bunch of hearts, a bunch of hearts, a bunch of hearts, a bunch of hearts. Just hit, hit, hit. We have some people that are in the room that I want to say hello to. Matt Price, Caitlin Joseph, Vincent Bailey Santa Maria, Davey McKay, Paul Coles II, Mariah Berry, Stephanie Macaluso Bartolo, and Charles Cantrell, thank you so much for joining us. And our first entertainer, our first soul, our first human being is this legend, the stunning Shishi LaRue. Why, hello, Shishi. You look like you have a bit of a highlight and a reflection on you.
Oh, look at that.
Hi!
Hello, hello, Shishi. How are you today?
I'm great. I'm happy to be here with you.
I'm so excited that you came on with us and that you're joining us. This is so amazing. I absolutely love that you were like, absolutely. And the timing was perfect because it was an hour before your show. And I was like, girl, you don't have to stop for an hour, just 10 to 15 minutes.
I love the fact that you're doing this. This resonates, this little topic.
Thank you. Thank you. And I think it's important. I think it's important.
Yeah.
You know, I really, 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 really do. Think it's important. Shishi, really quick. Charles Cantrell of Gate A says, miss you, Shishi.
Oh, hi, Charles.
Hi, Charles.
Charles and I need to hopefully talk about Gate A soon.
Yes.
Hey, Charles, while you're on there, how about some pool passes, man? What's up?
Right? We could give some pool passes away as prizes. Hello. If Gate A would do it.
Yes.
So, Shishi LaRue. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually put us into solo mode to where you are the main screen. And I would love for you to share your story with us. Are you good with that?
Sure.
All right, honey. So let's go ahead and whoopsie.
There.
All
right. Hi. Well, my name is Shishi LaRue, AKA Larry. I come from a small town in Minnesota called Hibbing, Minnesota, and I grew up there, and then I moved to Minneapolis and started doing drag in Minneapolis with a bunch of friends, and we called ourselves the Weather Gals, and we entered a contest at First Avenue, which is, of course, you know, the home of Purple Rain and Prince, and it was a straight club in Minneapolis, and they did a contest every Thursday called the Great Pretenders, and a bunch of us guys did hag drag, and we kept our beards on and did drag. That was called hag drag back in the day. Now it's called Bearded Drag. All right, so no, but I love you, Beyonce. You know I love you. And there's, listen, some of the bearded queens out there. Oh my God, the beauty. So I we entered that contest, we won, and then I moved from Minneapolis to Los Angeles in 1986, and had no idea what I was gonna do. I thought I was gonna be rich and famous and be a big movie star and a rock star and all the things that I thought I was gonna be, but I just thought that was gonna drop down from the sky and just scoop me up, that people were just gonna find me and say, oh my God, you'd be perfect. Like, you know, like I'm, I don't know, whoever, Greta Garbo or whoever was discovered in the coffee shop. And so I lived there for 35 years. And when I first moved there, I applied for a job at Catalina Video, and I got the job right away because of my knowledge of porno, adult films. And by the way, Beyonce, I love the word porno. I love it. I direct porn movies. You can call them adults, you can call them whatever, but I love the word porn. I think it's fabulous. Just like the word tranny, or just like the word faggot, or just like the word, all those words that I embrace, because I'm old, I'm 60 years old. And, you know, these words that are suddenly politically incorrect, I don't know. I, you know, and porn is one of the words that I love. I direct dirty, down and dirty, fabulous fucking porno movies.
I love porn. I mean, I love the word.
So, you know, or you could call them fuck flicks if you want, but
there you go.
Blue movies. Oh. So, you know, so I've directed films for 35 years, and I started to DJ about 15 years ago because, you know, as most directors and most drag queens, were control freaks. And I wanted to control the music in the clubs that I was going to. You know what I mean? I wanted to hear the music I wanted to hear. I wanted to hear more Cher. I wanted to hear more Kylie. I wanted to hear, you know, I wanted to porn as fuck. Yeah, Daniel. Fuck yeah, dude. Yeah. Hot mother. Oh, I'm sorry. And then, you know, so I just started DJing. And the very first time I ever DJed, Jackie Beat was DJing at a little bar called Foo Bar. And I went in there and practiced because it was like a Tuesday or something. There was nobody in there. And I practiced. And it was really fun. I really, really love DJing parties. So, you know, and I had gastric bypass surgery about 14 years ago and managed to keep it off, which is an accomplishment. I'm very proud of myself and very blessed that the weight has stayed off. In the interim of that, I became a raging alcoholic. And I don't know if it was because I was always an alcoholic or because the gastric bypass lended itself to take the alcohol I was consuming and make it a little more crazy in my body. And then, you know, I couldn't control my emotions with food anymore. I couldn't control, you know, that. So I turned to alcohol because alcohol made me fun and fabulous until it didn't. And then, you know, I went to rehab and was sober for 2 years. And then I started to relapse and get sober and relapse and get sober. And finally, I just decided I had enough. So I've been sober now for 13 months. And I don't see myself going back, but never say never. That's why you just take it one day at a time. And I've got a lot of people, my best friends, Roma, Shantae, you, Beyonce, everybody that supports me. I just, you know, I thank my lucky stars every day for the friends that I have. My sister, you know, I've got some great friends. There's an amazing family atmosphere in the adult industry. It's pretty amazing. If you've never experienced a family atmosphere, I also feel there's a family atmosphere in the drag world too, but not as much as the porn industry. We're all a little dysfunctional. We're all like Land of the Misfit Toys on Rudolph. So we've all got a little damage, and damage is okay. You know, it's like, as long as you don't let that define you or own you, then you can use your damages to your best, to make your best life. And that's pretty much it. That's my story. And to go with the theme, you know, I got a lot of dick when I was fat, you know, but fat in face, not just, you know, I couldn't really, I think it was because of my insecurities. I never really got a lot at all, really, when I was a boy. It was, you know, if I knew I was going to wanted to suck some dick, I had to like put a face on and go out, because I would get more, I would get, you know, it was like, I would do cocaine, I would drink, I would, you know, be in drag, I'd be out partying, I'd be the fabulous Shishi LaRue, I'm at a bar, I'm owning it, I'm bringing porn stars with me. You know, that whole facade. Huge facade. And I realized that I don't need the facade. Oh, thank you, Phil. Thank you, baby. I just, you know, I don't need that facade. I'm a 60-year-old bitch, a 60-year-old drunken, coked-out whore at a bar searching for cock is not pretty. So, you know, and I was always told, you know, you have such a gorgeous face. People would do my makeup. Oh, you have such a gorgeous face. You know, and sometimes I still look at myself and think that I'm a fat boy. I still buy. It's so weird because I'm also a shopaholic. So whenever I see a, you know, a body shaper or a garment that sucks you in, even though I don't need to be sucked in.
You don't need it whatsoever.
And I still buy them.
You are a shopaholic, because I think the last time I saw you on Instagram, we were talking and you had like that hat you were wearing, you had all of them in every single color.
Oh, you mean the fedora?
Yeah, the fedora. Yeah, yeah.
You mean this?
You mean that one?
Oh, wow.
You mean this?
Those are beautiful. Oh my god.
Or this?
That's
a yellow one around here, and a green one, and a purple one, and a gray one.
Those are showstoppers right there.
Honey, go to Santee Alley, downtown LA. They're $10.
I love LA. I love LA. So Shishi, so on the SASS side of it, before we get to the science side of it, on the SASS side of it. So you're sitting there and you were saying how, you know, you got so much dick, but you had to put a face on. Yeah. Right? I think that's funny because I get in drag and bitches are like, no. Except for my boyfriend. I call my boyfriend a glitter chaser, because if he sees a dude that does drag like with a beard, like a daddy that does a beard, he 100% is just like, babe, check this guy out. And I'm like, you're
such a Dan, man. Be careful.
So he chases the sisters of perpetual indulgence then.
He chases all of them. All of the daddies that have beards, that have faces, I'm like, you're a glitter chaser.
I think they call the guys that chase bearded drag queens clown chasers, or the sisters, I'm sorry, clown chasers, I think. I don't know. It's like, there's something for everybody, girl.
Right. But so I have a question for you. Yeah. So did you notice when you got the surgery that your penis got bigger?
My what?
That your penis got bigger?
I could see it finally.
So it exists now.
I mean, you know, I don't have a very large penis. So, you know, it's like, I never really noticed. Yeah, I guess. I mean, you know, when you have a stomach that goes out, the penis pulls in. So, you know, I mean, I'm not a size queen, so I don't really care. I just love all naked men. And I also like to eat butt a lot, so sometimes I don't even care about the dick.
Me too. Have you heard of Studio Ready, girl? Have you heard of Studio Ready?
Studio Ready, what's that?
Oh, okay. So here's a quick little tea, really quick, and then we're gonna have Eric get into the science side.
Oh, okay.
So Studio Ready is a coffee. They have different flavors, but Dan got me the coffee flavored one. It is a exfoliant scrub made with coffee grounds And also,
oh, I think, yes, I know, yes. I have a bunch of beer in my closet.
Girl, it's in my shower, honey. Actually, we had sex the other night, and I was going down giving him a rim job, and I was like, I don't smell no espresso down here, so obviously you're not waking me up right now. What's happening? He's watching.
You know what? I don't know if I want, you know, that's the thing. I don't want a man's butthole to smell like strawberry sherbet or anything like that.
Oh, I don't want strawberry sherbet, but coffee, I'm all about it.
Oh, okay.
I love some coffee.
Wake me up before I come. Hello.
Yes, hello. Okay, girl.
So, oh, man.
All right, science. So,
my question. Are you ready, yes. Chief, for my question?
Yes.
So, for me, as a healthcare provider, right, oftentimes people with all sorts of addiction, whether it be alcohol or cocaine or anything in between, come to us. We're the first people they come to look for help. And there are different ways of taking care of addiction, and I'm wondering, were there any medications that worked for you in your experience? Was there something that maybe, because let's be honest, medications these days are assist. It's really you that is in control. But what assistance did it offer you?
I say whatever works. I say whatever works to get me to not be in the state of where I'm passing out and breaking my nose, or I am going into seizures, or I'm hallucinating, or whatever. I'd say whatever works. Because I don't ever want to do that again. And I know that I'm just a sip away from starting that again, and I don't want that. I went to my doctor. I changed my doctor and went to him, and I just told him everything. I was an open book to my doctor. You have to be an open book to your doctor. You have to tell your doctor everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, just tell your doctor everything. I told him I was an alcoholic, that I was gay, that I was, ass eater, fucking drag queen, blah, blah, blah.
You know, true health, that means you're normal, right?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yes. And that's the one thing I love about true health is they are all about being like, so tell me the real tea. What is
sex positivity? You know, I believe in sex positivity. So but as far as I go with my, I changed my antidepressant medication because I was, had a depression. I have a depression, mm-hmm. and I changed that. And then I asked my doctor. I said, please put me on antabuse because I need assistance. I need a little help with this. And so we talked about it. And if you're unfamiliar with what antabuse is a medication that you take it and it lasts in your system. Each time you take it, each dose, it lasts in your system for like about 10 days.
Yeah.
If you drink alcohol while you're on antabuse, you become, with just one sip of alcohol, you become violently ill.
And the word is violent.
Yes, like really? Violent, shitting, violent, throwing up. You're not good. You have to go to the hospital. It takes you down for like 2 days. So it's like a bug zapper. I said, I want that bug zapper in me. I don't want to go near the bug zapper. You know, I want that crutch. I need it. And I'm not embarrassed to say that I need that crutch. I'm not strong enough. I am not. Hi, New Orleans.
Hi, Scott.
I am not strong enough, so I needed a little help. And
can I cut you really quick right there?
Shishi? Yes.
Because I know personally you feel like you might not be strong enough, but I'm going to say that you gave me an example of your strength this past Gay Days during the pageant because somebody wanted to bring you a drink. And you said, yes, I would appreciate that, but absolutely no alcohol. Bravo to you for that.
Well, you know, and also when you go and when you're doing drag shows and they want to give you a shot, if you don't take the shot, they get really mad.
Yeah. Yes.
It's like, okay, please take the shot. So I've learned to do this. I've learned to tell the bartenders at clubs, if somebody wants to buy me a shot, just make me a bar shot, which is basically soda or water. You know, so I just, you know, I get by fine with a sugar-free Red Bull. I love after a gig, after a show, going home, taking the makeup off instead of falling asleep in it or passing out in it mm-hmm. or falling down on the sideway in it and waking up in the morning and be able to go to Starbucks and have my which is an addiction also. And I haven't, there's no Starbucks around me that opens, so I'm going to Caribou, which is my second, which is the second best to me.
Right.
So, you know, I'm just grateful and blessed and that I am sober and that I can remember every day.
And we thank you so much.
I have a question just to like, for my knowledge, right? So do you feel that you needed that violent, negative reaction as part of like that negative conditioning, right?
I never drank on the antabuse.
Oh, okay, and this is the reason why I ask is because nowadays what we're using is naltrexone, and naltrexone basically, you would never get drunk even if you wanted to. So what happens?
Oh, I've heard of that, but you know, God,
there's no reaction. There's no negative reaction, but it also doesn't give you. It doesn't allow you to have what you're looking for.
I don't want to drink because I like the taste of alcohol. I want to drink because I want to forget everything that I have to do. Mm-hmm. I want to disconnect myself from the world. And my friends always know.
Well, honey, you're getting up in age, so that's going to happen soon.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I don't, I mean, it's like, you know, I don't need that much. Forget everything. Yeah. But my friends know that if I'm off of social media for longer than a day, then they should probably find out what's going on.
We're going to go ahead and we are going to bring on our next human being, Shishi LaRue. Thank you so much.
Can I say one thing? If you're on Instagram today at 3:00, half an hour from now, but you'll probably still be on here watching, I do an Instagram live show where I talk to porn stars, drag queens, and different weirdos. So come on Instagram.
If you're going to need treatment or prep, come to your house.
Exactly. All right. I love you. Thank you so much.
I love you too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Eric. Thank you, Beyonce.
Yes. Thank you. Mwah. I love you. Bye bye. I love Shishi. So we have Scott Plunkett saying hi from New Orleans. Love this discussion. Ramon Rosado, hi from Florida. Michelle Bonewoods, hello. Daniel survives on coffee, which is true. I bought 2 packets of friggin' like 48 cups each. They're gone. I already had to go buy 2 more.
And Jarell is also in the room.
Yes.
Bobby Haynes.
Yes. All of these amazing people here. Wow. So speaking of amazing people, and this little quote that she has, faces are like bicycle seats. They all are fun to ride. I love that. Love it. So our next amazing human being, like I said, when you speak to this person, you're going to understand why I'm obsessed with her. There's a quick little backdrop of my experience with Christina, aka Faith Taylor, was I was in a pageant at one time. It was my second pageant years ago. And I placed. And I placed first runner-up. And the person that lost below me took their second runner-up placement, went in the back room, threw it up against the wall, it crashed, and like the glass everywhere. And then the next day proceeded to go online and take a picture of me and go, this just beat me in the pageant. I understand that my drag aesthetic is completely different, and there is no way that I can say that I am, you know, sitting there going up against people that are doing female illusion or a transgender pageant at all. Mine is about the blend of gender. Mine is about having the ability of looking beyond the binary. And Faith immediately Christina came to my defense within those comments and was like, and I'm not gonna say who this person was. And she said, listen, I know you and you're a fantastic person and an entertainer, but you also have to understand that Beyonce is an amazing person, a fantastic artist and extremely entertaining. And that right there resonated with me so much that somebody of the caliber of Faith Taylor basically defended me, you know? So Eric, you are going to have the pleasure of meeting this soul.
I am. And you know what, I'm kind of curious because the interesting part is that Beyonce, ironically enough, you and I do very similar things in that you blend two genders and maybe that too. But I also help to people to change gender or to stay gender neutral, or, you know, I see that happening more and more these days. where people truly do identify as non-binary, and they want the makeup of their physical appearance on the outside to match the inside. So we do that as well. Yeah.
Right. Right. So, and that's the one thing that I absolutely love about Crew Health is that you guys, you know, do bring everybody. So we are going to bring Christina Gariba, Faith Taylor, onto the screen. Hello, Faith Taylor. Can you hear us?
Hey.
Hi. How are you?
How are you?
Doing fantastic. Fantastic.
Welcome.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
You look How fabulous.
Well, thank you. This took me about 3 seconds.
So, Christina, you know, honestly, like.
I can't hear you.
Oh, there, I'll tell you. She can't hear you.
You can't hear me.
Here we go again.
Here we go again. Here
it's
we
better
go.
This way.
It is. It is. Eric, if you could just tell the Faith, just okay. Thank you so much for joining us and to come on and tell her story.
Do you mean something?
I'm going to be Beyonce for a moment. Thank you for joining us. And we're going to move our screens around so you can tell your story, okay?
All right. Hi, my name is Christina Gariba. I also go by Faith Taylor on stage. I am a local entertainer in the Jacksonville, Florida area. Been entertaining about 16 years. That's a long time to be in the business. Longer than a lot and not as long as many. I grew up just on the other side of the St. John's River in Orange Park. It was a terrible, terrible Republican hellhole that I still refuse to go to this day, even for family gatherings. Growing up for me as a gay boy was super tough. I experienced a lot of bullying, I was targeted a lot by the school system, the teachers, principals. I guess I was just an easy target at that point. And so it was pretty rough for me. I moved around from school to school to school, you know, trying to find somebody that was, or a school that gave a shit, I guess. And I had some good teachers along the way, but I don't know that I went to any good schools here. So anyways, from there, I went to Douglas Anderson School of the Performing Arts, where I was a vocal major. I don't know if you know that, but I used to be a singer. I still can kind of sing, but just, I suppose you could say my singing voice doesn't match my gender now that I'm older and puberty's hit. So, I work primarily at Hamburger Mary's. I'm the show director at the University Club in Gainesville on Thursday nights, which was formerly ran by the late Lady Pearl. I just started my own nonprofit organization after spending several years volunteering at a summer camp for transgender youth. I started my own program just about a month and a half ago.
Ooh, can you give us a name for that program?
Yeah, it's called Transcending Adolescence.
Yeah, and is that located in Jacksonville? Is there a website?
This is where we're based out of. It's still in the very beginning phases. You know, we're working on the programming and everything to make it perfect and just kind of fundraising from behind the scenes and just starting to put everything together for the program. It's going to be a really interesting program.
Awesome, awesome.
I really love that you're talking about pretty faces, because I can't tell you how many times I've heard, you know, well, you're really hot, but you're a dude, you know, and I suppose it's just people that don't understand. That's what I like to say that it is.
On that topic of people not understanding, do you feel that used to be a thing of the past? Do you feel like you experience that less and less today, or is it the same?
I definitely think it's less and less. I mean, if I'm honest, I never want to boast, but you know, I have a pretty face, and I've pretty much always, you know, they've said, you know, well, I'm not. Instead of, you have a pretty face, but you're a dude. It's, you know, you're a guy, but you're hot. So I'll still do you. So it's kind of a little bit. I'm sorry?
Does that bother you in any way? Or do you see this as a progression here?
I think at one point it did, but I, you know, the reason, I guess now's as good a time as any to delve into the topic, the programming of my organization. You know, the idea behind it is to teach kids how to cope with being trans in a world of people who don't understand us.
Right.
I think at one point it really did bother me, but once I just started to relax and stop trying to make everybody see my point and, you know, this is the way that it is. I identify as a woman. I am a woman. And people just are not going to understand that. And you can't change everybody and you can't educate everyone. So you just kind of have to, I say deal with it loosely, but when I say deal with it, I mean more like, you have to be okay within yourself to be able to hear that and not let it get to you.
Oh yeah.
So that's totally basically agree. The idea of the program is to teach kids to be happy with themselves.
And I think that's a very important learning tool that we need to all learn. Because I know as a gay boy, young and early, I was like, okay, how do I love myself? How do I accept myself? It was definitely a struggle, and it's something that, you know, I think all of us go through in different ways, depending on what our journey is.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, I think the toughest time for me was when I was finding out who I am, and I was at that weird in-between phase, and, you know, I wasn't a tranny or a transsexual. Back then, transgender wasn't like a big thing. So that wasn't like that wasn't terminology that we used back then. But I wasn't a gay boy because I looked like a girl and I lived as a woman, but I wasn't a woman because I had no breasts and a dick. So what am I, who am I, and where do I fit in and who's going to love me? You know, because I had a lot of guys, you know, I was always very pretty. And, you know, I painted my nails and in my early years in high school, you know, I was learning to be myself. I was at Douglas Anderson School of the Performing Arts, which you can imagine was just a world of people who are embracing themselves. And it was a really embracing environment. That was the one school that I found that did embrace who the people were, who the students were.
And it's hard to create this change in people. I will tell you firsthand from a clinical perspective, I take care of a lot of transgender patients, and I'm very happy to do so. And it's kind of sad because we live in Orlando, Florida. You're in Jacksonville, for example. My most northern patient is probably in Tallahassee, and my most southern patient is in Fort Pierce. And that's not a good thing. Actually, that's a bad thing, because that means that they have to travel 2+ hours to actually get trans competent care, and that's horrible. Tell you a quick story. This week, actually, I had one person call in to cancel their appointment. It's a 19-year-old transgender patient from male to female, and said, "Oh, my parents found my estrogen pills, and they told me if I didn't stop my transition, that they would kick me out of the house at a 19.
That's horrible.
Mm-hmm.
That's so awful. You know, we at working at the camp, it was odd for me because the programming of the camp is the idea of that particular one is to, I'm talking about the camp for transgender youth that I volunteered at, is we want the kids to come here, be themselves, be happy, think about camp and nothing else. They don't want the kids talking to each other about their transitions because Susie Q may not come from a supportive family. And, and Patricia does come from a supportive family. So as Patricia's talking about how great, how big her boobs are getting on hormones, Susie Q is over here, you know, you just sent her into a whirlwind of depression and anxiety that she wouldn't feel otherwise. So that's why they don't allow the kids to talk about those things at camp. But, you know, kids come from all different, you know, families. I mean, not kids, people. Yeah. You know, there are adults who still don't have relationships with their parents because they've made this decision to be a transformer.
Can you hear me? You say transformer, I say outside the shell. You know.
Yeah.
Eric, can you hear me?
Yeah, I always say every time I tuck.
Faith, can you hear me?
Every time I tuck, I say transformers.
So Faith still can't hear me. So Eric, if you will ask her this question.
I heard you for a minute, but.
If you would ask me, a question for me, that would be fantastic. Do you think it is important for if accidentally somebody misgenders somebody, do you think it is important for a person that is transgender to correct and educate or to get defensive? Because that actually happened to me. I accidentally, especially because this person was or is female to male, but also does drag. And so in the world of the drag world, everybody's like, hey, girl,
you're
hey,
gonna
girl,
have
hey,
to
girl.
Fill me in because I can't hear anything.
I got you, don't worry.
Everybody's like, hey, girl, hey, girl, hey, girl. And then all of a sudden, like, this person went on a rage on social media, didn't mention my name, but I knew exactly who they were talking about. And a year later, I went and apologized to them, and they were like, oh, I'm just having a bad day. But instead of coming to me and educating me on, I know I do drag, but when I'm not in drag, please address me as he or they. So how important is it for people to that are transgender to educate, even within the gay community, or the LGBTQ plus community, to educate versus getting defensive?
So I'm going to condense this for a little bit. Make it a little fast. She did a lot of talking, a lot. So, and this is kind of a very, maybe a simple topic for you that you've dealt with very early on, is when it comes to misgendering, let's say someone misgenders you, right? What role or approach do you think is best or people should take on? Do you think that we should do the educational route and kind of like, no, I am he, they, she, and go by pronoun and kind of start educating on pronouns, whether it's within our own gay community or even outside of our gay community? Beyonce shared, this is why she elaborated, she shared an experience where there's actually a transgender performer that is female to male and performs as a female illusionist. Is that correct, Beyonce? Yes, that's correct.
Victor Victoria.
Is that person that does that?
No, it's a movie with Julie Andrews.
Yeah. Oh, okay. And I think Beyonce ran into that prop accidentally where there was a misgendering. How do you address that?
I think that it depends on the situation. I don't think I'm going to take the time to correct the clerk at Walmart who called me sir, that's just not the time for it. I was going to say, or the drive-through, you know, sometimes my voice might be a little deeper than normal, you know, they might say sir or, you know, versus ma'am. But, you know, there are times when, depending on my mood or my patience level, I suppose, where I'll correct them at the drive-through because that's an easy fix for them. You can be a voice in a box and use terms that, or affirmations that aren't gendered. I think that making people aware that you don't always have to, it's easy to do, but there are ways to do it without gendering, the remark, I suppose. But, you know, friends or the public, you know, I would certainly address the situation. And I think that a good approach to that is, you know, just, hey, you know, for the record or for future reference, you know, I use she pronouns, you know, so I would appreciate it if you would show me that respect. And I think that genuinely asking for someone's respect kindly is the best way to do it because people feel that it's genuine versus trying to attack them and say, how dare you call me that? You don't know who I am. And, you know, and go off. You're just looking, making us look like crazy people, which they already think that we are. So can we not?
Very true. Very true. I'll fill in Garante with your responses. I want to thank you so much for joining us and kind of shedding some light on a lot of these topics that a lot of us have. And we will see you soon, I'm sure.
Thank you so much for having me.
Mwah. We love you. See you soon.
Love you, Bear.
Okay. I don't know why she couldn't hear me.
I don't know.
Can everybody else hear me? If you can hear me, please give me a bunch of hearts. So that I want to make sure that my microphone is working. So give us a bunch of hearts if you can hear me. And let's also give a bunch of hearts if you can hear Eric. So a bunch of hearts if you can hear me. And Eric from Crew Health.
I'm looking for hearts to see if people can hear me. Can you guys hear me out there? I see Dan, give me some hearts. Yeah, we got Michelle, some hearts.
Yay! Okay. So we've talked about two amazing subjects. Addiction, alcoholism associated with bariatric surgery, with a drag queen, within a drag queen, porn entertainer or porn director, you know, Gigi LaRue. Then we're talking about transgender and misgender and just going on the fact that, you know, so many people are still, even in this day and age, having to fight for who they are with Faith Taylor. The next person that we are going to bring in is another amazing entertainer that is also an amazing human being. Is also a fellow hairstylist. So
Okay.
Understands the side of beauty, okay? So if we can all give a bunch of hearts, if you guys could share this this feed, that would be amazing so that we could spread these messages because you want to know what? I'm sick and tired of hearing. Oh, you have such a pretty face, but okay.
It's over.
It's done. It's done. I say it's done.
We just need a gavel.
But we need a gavel, exactly, like freaking Judge Judy. So please welcome next up into the guest list, JC Ray, also known as Crystal Michaels. Ooh. Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you loud and clear.
Can you hear Eric?
Can you hear me?
Speak to me in that deep voice again.
Ooh, can you hear me?
Daddy, yes, I can hear you.
Okay. So JC, Crystal, I'm so used to calling you Crystal, but JC, thank you so much for speaking to us today about your story of beauty. You know, I think it's extremely important for people to understand this. And, you know, I let Eric have the floor last time, so now I'm about to, and that's because I couldn't speak with Faith. So now it's my turn, but no, I'm just kidding. So we're going to bring you into where your solo frame and just share your story with us, you know, because I think it's so important because so many people are out there and I think it's hilarious because like right now with the coronavirus and everything like that or COVID-19 going on that, you know, people are like, my eyelash extensions are gone. My Botox is wearing off. My hair, I have roots, you know, I need a haircut and stuff like that. So your story is extremely important, especially right now, you know? So
yeah, it's kind of, it's important, but it's not doing me any good right now, but it's okay.
Right. So we're gonna go ahead and bring you into solo mode. Please introduce yourself and then go ahead and tell your story because then next we have Perfect Break. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I wanna say thank you to Eric and thank you to Beyonce Bear for having me on today. This is a great opportunity. And I have to say that, Shishi, I have been a fan and idolized you for many, many years. And I still someday hope I get the opportunity to be pulled around in a red radio flyer wagon holding your hair. And I'll even dress up like a little clown or a little elf. But my name is JC Ray. I've gone by a couple different stage names over the years, but let me go back to I grew up in northern Maine and the most northernest point of the United States, right next to Fort Kent in a town called Van Buren. Very small town, less than 4,000 people. I became an orphan when I was 9 years old. Unfortunately, my mom died of Cushing's disease. And I kind of bounced around in foster homes and wasn't the best childhood. But I was blessed and I was born with the drive and the tenacity to overcome hurdles and things that life has thrown at me. And I've had a really blessed life. I never have ever let the unfortunate mishaps and hurdles in my childhood stopped me from achieving my dreams. So I'm going to fast forward this, and anybody that ever wants to know more just to help them get through their journey, they're more than willing to reach out to me, and I'm happy to share my story in depth. Back in 2006, I was really coming into my own and becoming a hairstylist, which was a dream of mine from the time I can remember. I always wanted to be a hairstylist. I was given a God-gift talent that I could make beautiful hair and make people feel good and look good in the mirror and give them the confidence that it takes to be able to go through life and get through the things that life throws us. So in 2006, I was blessed and able to be on a little show that was kind of nationally known as Split Ends, which was, as I like to describe it, it was like wife swap for hairdressers. And I did that show in drag, and back then my stage name was Crystal Mess, and Crystal Mess came from one losing a very dear, dear close friend to the drug crystal meth on Christmas morning, and also from my own struggle of addiction. And so here I am, this small town boy from northern Maine, who's also a drag queen, and doing the show, and it opened up a lot of doors for me. And, I was able to open up my own salon and ran a successful business for 8 years in Massachusetts. And fast forward, and why I really wanted to speak to everybody today was I told myself at 20 years old that at the age of 40, I would go in and I would have myself a makeover, cosmetic surgery, elective surgery. I'm the first to admit that nobody really needs surgery unless you have born with a defect that prevents you from going through life and achieving the things that can be achieved on just an everyday normal, what we take for granted, people that are born without any birth defects. If that can change your life in the positive, then yes, I do believe that that is something that plastic surgery is a necessity. But other than that, I look at plastic surgery as I have women who come to see me every 5, every 6 weeks. They spend $150 or upwards of more to see them in the mirror at the end of the appointment booked with me and feel good about themselves. So what is the difference if I chose at the age of 40 to go in and rejuvenate my face? I don't see anything different in that. So if you can tell me something different or have an argument that would make me not admit that I was probably one of the vainest people that you'll ever meet. And I'm proud of that because I take pride in my image, because that's what I sell. I sell an image. I sell the confidence to let people believe that I can make them look their best. So I went in a year ago, March 24th, and I had extensive plastic surgery done. I had a lot done to my face, and I did not do it for anybody but myself. I didn't care what anybody else thought. I was going in and I was going to have done what I saw as an imperfection or something that I didn't like and I knew could be corrected. There's a lot of details I cannot get into because unfortunately, I woke up from that surgery and had a complete nervous mental breakdown. It completely turned my life upside down financially. I spent almost 3 months a recluse in the house. I would get up in the morning and I would walk in the bathroom and the first thing I would look at is the mirror and it would completely ruin my day. I sit here now today, a year later, and I'm dealing with, as everybody else is dealing with, we are all in this together and we're all dealing with what COVID-19 has brought upon us. individually. And I say that because we don't have the same situation as the person who lives next door to us, but we all are in this together. And it comes down to, a year ago, I have a surgery that completely takes everything that I thought I knew and it turns it upside down. And I come to this panel today to really let people know that mental health, may it not be seen every day, but it exists. It is something that is should be and needs to be, and with myself, is taken very seriously. We all strive for a better tomorrow. And when I say that, if we don't push ourselves to be better than we were yesterday, if we don't take time to reflect on what happened yesterday and try to improve it today or tomorrow, then we have other problems that we need to deal with. But our mental stability is something that is so important that is connected to every other aspect of our lives, and no plastic surgery will ever fix that. We live in a society where it's very quick to want the instant gratification. It's very quick to pass judgment on somebody else based off of their physical attributes. But what we don't really stop and do a lot of the times, and I'm guilty of it myself, is we don't get or take the time to find out what's behind that pretty face that so many others can see. And there's a lot of times for those who do have a pretty face, they don't see it. And so they get misjudged, they get interpreted the wrong way, and it causes a lot of emotional turmoil internally. So
Crystal, if I can ask you, do you feel now after your after everything has been said and done and the healing and the swelling from the surgery, everything has gone down, do you like the results that you have? Or do you feel that, is it a mixed bag? How do you feel about that?
Having been I'm such a very detailed oriented person, I'm very visual. I look at what was done and there are things that were not done correctly. And part of my mental health and having, OCD and things like that, I asphyxiated on that. But I have to say that I look at the silver lining of what this is a year later. Had I been this business owner with this massive house and, I laugh and I said, yeah, I knew it was time when I spent $3,000 a year on the landscaping for the neighbors to have a nice yard. And I worked all the time. And now my life is completely different. I live in a very small condo. It's very quiet compared to what it was. There are other things in life that you need to worry about. And to the average person that sees me, they think I look fine. And you know what? I guess that's what I was looking for. And I'm not settling, but I'm accepting what is and going to go with what I can change.
You know,
does that make sense? I guess, is that?
Oh, it completely
makes sense. Yeah. Am I happy with it? I don't think I'd ever be 100% happy with something I know isn't right. But do I have to accept it? Yes, I have to. And I have to look at what the good things are. I can't focus on the negative, because if I do, I'm not going to progress in life.
True. Very true. And we always need to progress in life.
Oh,
I find it interesting because you, in your storytelling, you actually conveyed to everyone something, a concept that's very important. And that's the image of self. What you see in the mirror and how you see yourself in here are two different things. And sometimes they align and sometimes they don't align. So for example, in your particular case, those two images were not aligning. And that's actually a sense of dysphoria that happens. And we see that a lot in transgender people, where like they look at themselves and they're, why do I have a beard? Why don't, when they might see themselves as a woman or vice versa. So that in dysphoria can be extremely jarring and can shake anyone up. And I'm very happy that you were able to share that with us.
Oh, absolutely. And I definitely want to show this picture really quick because I didn't show it before I brought you on and I apologize. So I'm going to show it right now because I will tell you right now, this is perfection. Like, and I think all of us look in the mirror and we will always find something negative. We'll always. I mean, I look in the mirror now and I'm like, oh, like, and I sit there and I go, oh.
Girl, I think you look fabulous. The only thing I'm envious of is the fact that you can pull off a big, full beard like that and still have a highlight like I kill for, okay, babe?
And still have a what?
And still have a highlight I kill for.
Yeah, a little extra light. I mean, but look at this. Look. I mean,
wow.
That is perfection. But do you want to know what I love about this picture? And I like really quick, I want to dissect this picture. On the left, I see a extremely happy person, but at the same time, that has a lot of question that's going on in their head. But I see a confidence. I see a way that you're looking at the camera, and I love that it's black and white because it's like you've taken away the visual aspect of what everybody sees today, and that, whether that gender or whether that's, you know, race or, you know, whatever. It's black.
Can I be the typical cisgendered male right now and be like, look at those legs. Oh.
And then you look to, then you look over and you see Crystal and you're like, oh. Oh. Like, right? You know,
the thing about it for me, and I have to say this because I want other people out there that struggle and they're so afraid of what people think of them. And I have to say this, perception is the reality for a lot of people.
Right.
And that is so unfortunate because what your perception of my reality is only your reality.
Which goes back to the whole, they have a pretty face, but because you don't know what that person, you don't know what that person is going through. You don't know that person's story.
I don't know that struggle that is inside of that person, that even myself who have struggled and have my own issues, I put a wall up. So when I do a black and white photo, there shows confidence. But behind that, there is a vulnerable human being in all of us.
Right.
Yeah. So I'm going to be honest, that photo shows pure confidence.
Absolute.
That was like after a 3-hour color job, I'm gonna be honest. I was like so ready for a cigarette and just like, oh, this queen.
Oh my god.
I love your quote that you say, it's not where you are, but the people you are with that matter. And yeah. It was funny because I said, well, who said that, girl? And you were like, me. Like, I was like, well, who's it by? And you're like, me. And I was like, oh, look at it. Okay. All right. She's now a poet and a motivational speaker and everything. You know,
I said that for the first time and publicly was when I was buying my first house. And I said to myself, oh my God, this is awful. What am I doing? Like, what am I doing? And then I thought to myself, it does not matter where you are. What matters are the people that you're with. Mm-hmm. And I truly believe that. And the person that I said it to took what I said to such heart and said, wow, that really makes sense. And he went and he had my picture that was on from Fire Island one year in 4th of July, Invasion of the Pines. I mean, my birthday happens to be 4th of July. So I had friends that have a house in Fire Island and they brought me there and it was unbelievable. I was Rosebud's lime juice that year.
Do you know Zola?
I'm sorry?
You know Zola, I think that's her name.
Zola?
Fire Island.
I've only met Daisy that I okay. can tell you. But I do remember when Bianca Del Rio was not famous and she was hawking those horrible jokes in Fire Island at the you know, the pool area. I remember those days. Yes. And right. You know, because earlier she was talking about Jackie B. You know, I was Jackie B and Jimmy James's cocktail waiter in P-Town 2 years. Oh my God, those queens taught me everything.
That's fantastic.
And Jackie B would stand there out there barking for her show and people would walk by and she'd go, you're on vacation. Could you at least smile?
You at least smile, right. And that's one thing, and even that means so much because so many people walk around today with this like look on their face of just disgusting.
Well, it's resting permanent bitch face. It's just, yes. Some of it's naturally born with it. And when you meet people, it's right back to perception. You can have the most amazing personality, be the most in-depth person that you sit down and talk with, but that resting bitch face just gives it away.
Just gives it away. Just gives it away. Just gives it away. Just gives it away. So, JC, thank you so much for coming on with us today. I see our next and final guest sitting in the green room. She's been fanning herself, going, bitch, really? You've been keeping me sitting here for an hour? Like,
I said, thank you so much. And please be safe. And we will get through this. And when we do, I better get a ticket to that pool party. I've got a nice bathing suit.
Right, I am sure. So, thank you so much, JC, for joining us.
Thank you, JC.
Bye, honey. You know, and I think that's, I think, Eric, like, on your scientific side, do you find that people are getting more cosmetic surgery today because of the whole instant gratification, like Insta-famous? Or do you think they're getting it because of medical? Like, do you think they're getting it because of the lack of
hygiene? I think as a medical society, I feel that we are moving in a different direction, which is kind of interesting. I love that our transgender population is actually pushing us in that direction right now. The way that they are pushing us is they're getting us to getting, and when I say get us, they're getting the rest of the population, everyone else that's not transgender, to better understand that sometimes some of these things are medically necessary. And that's the thing that I actually, even I discovered recently when we went to Harvard last year for transgender guidelines, we discovered that, hey, guess what? The definition of medically necessary doesn't mean I can't live without this. It means that this is necessary for quality of life at this point in time. So any transgender person that comes to Crew Health, for example, even in our first note from our visiting counter, we discussed, check this out. And this is hard to get because a lot of people don't write this down. People can't get transgender surgery, for example, unless they have a letter from a healthcare provider. And from us, it's actually in note number one in our first visit. It specifies that we will use treatment to the best of our abilities. But anything beyond that, that means that cosmetic surgery or, you know, those surgical interventions will be defined as medically necessary.
Wow.
So the same thing is true for all of us. We can lose weight. We can do all these things. But if we hit that wall that we cannot go any further and we will not go any further, we may need to take that next step.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Well, let's go ahead and bring on our next guest. I was painting my room this past weekend.
My favorite color.
Huh?
You painted it my favorite color.
A baby blue? Yes. Yeah. Listen, it was baby shit green. It was like I would wake up and I would immediately have fluid bowel movements. I've been now for the past 4 days, I've been constipated because I don't have shit in the morning.
Oh.
That's what I'm blaming this weight on, is constipation, okay? But no. So really quick, I just want to say hello to a couple people that are in
the room. I see Jeff in the house right there.
I'm sorry?
We say Jeff is in the house.
We say hello to Jeff. Hello.
John Porto. We have Brad Allen. Wow. I think Brad Allen's been here all day long, let's be honest.
Ricky Beard. We gotta love Ricky Beard. He's fantastic. Oh, yeah. Diana Fabulash, Ronnie Amores, Derek Lee. Oh, I miss you guys so much. Come on, Sate. Manuel Morales, Joe Reed, if you guys are still in here, thank you. Tanya Whalen Hendricks, that is a dear friend of mine. Amazing. She's a cosmetology instructor, or actually, she's the head of the department. Randy Rude, Harry Greer, if you guys are all in the room, thank you guys so much for being in here and watching and joining the show today. So if we get a bunch of hearts for our next entertainer who's been sitting in the green room for the past hour and 13 minutes, I really appreciate your patience. This next soul, this next human being, when I had gone live while I was painting and waiting for the paint to dry, discussing about that we were looking for people to come on and speak about their story. They immediately messaged me, was like, I have lost X amount of pounds because I'm gonna let them tell their story. So I have lost X amount of pounds and I want to share that with you. And I was like, absolutely. So, of course, I put him in the last run of the show. I'm sorry, Eartha. Please, ladies, gentlemen, he, she, Dave, everybody out there, this stunning human being, Luke Jarman, aka Eartha Quake. Hello, can you hear me?
I can.
Can you hear Eric?
Can you hear me?
I can. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. We can hear you. That's right. Just a simple hairdo for you. That's
you know what? We're 2 seconds away from a Verizon commercial.
Really easy. Just woke up.
Did you just put it on? Or did you just wake up and just wrap it up in a towel and came out like that?
Like a Disney princess, I just roll out of bed.
Well, honey, if you've seen Frozen, you know that Anna does not wake up all cute. Mm-hmm. So don't say Disney princess because she's
maybe like a 1960s Disney.
Oh, okay. 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 Okay.
Lord knows I'm old enough.
So, Eartha Quake, thank you so much for joining us today. I'm sorry that we have kept you waiting.
It's my pleasure.
I know that you have your show that you are going. And so this is my roommate. Pop us some popcorn, Miss Eartha.
Oh, God.
If you do not know, Eartha Quake has a series called Cooking with Eartha. It is on YouTube, correct?
It is transitioning to YouTube. It can be found on my Facebook or the Balcony page, which is a local channel here in Boise, Idaho.
Okay, Boise, Idaho. Idaho, Utah, Weedaho.
Idaho, I the number one hoe.
Yes. So I am going to remove us and put you into solo mode so that you can tell your story.
All right. Okay. All right. Well, like they said, my name is Eartha Quake, or Luke Jarman. I'm 38 years old. I am a husband, a father of one beautiful 10-year-old girl. And I was really reflecting. I was talking with Berense about what my story was and weight loss. And I thought that that was my biggest inner beauty story and transition. I have, over the past 2 years, or this October will be 3 years, I have lost 244 pounds. I reflected as a father and what was important to me. It had nothing to do with beauty. It had nothing to do with aesthetic, and it had to do 100% with being connected to the people that I love and being able to be there for them.
Eartha, yes. So talking about the aesthetic, we have Jeremy Wheat in the chat room, and he wants to know, I don't get why drag queens have beards. Can you tell us a little bit more about that aesthetic so we can enlighten?
The aesthetic of beards?
Beards on drag queens.
For me, it's just very androgynous. It's marrying I've always struggled with masculine versus feminine, and I've always defined who I am based on whether or not I'm mask or femme or whatever. And for me, I love to entertain. I love to perform. I love to bring people joy. I do comedy here when I'm not a big ogre working queen selling jello shots. But for me, it was just a perfect marrying of both lives that I'm so in love with, my masculinity and the femininity that's internal, that I wanted to bring the two together. And so that's 100% what it is for me. I just never have wanted to be a non-bearded queen. I love it.
I'm going to be honest, from my perspective, shaving is no fun either. So
the what?
Shaving is not going to be any fun either.
Oh, God, it's a pain in the ass. Let's get real. I'm 38. I was married. I grew up in a really, I grew up in Boise, Idaho. I'm a native. I grew up in a really conservative home. My parents are very religious. And so coming out at a young age was very difficult. I did it at first. And just the amount of struggle that I got and the backlash that I got from all my family and friends in school and the community, I went back into the closet. I met my ex-wife when I was in high school. She is one of my dearest friends. We are so close, and so she is such a blessing in my life. But we were together for 16 years, or 15, around there. We formed a family together. We had a very authentic, very genuine marriage. I don't want to say anything that will take away from that because I was very devoted to my family. We have a daughter together, and we were sitting on our back patio one night, and she's, just asked me if I had ever thought of ourselves as just roommates. And in open dialogue with each other, we realized that we were not giving our daughter the example of what a marriage and intimacy and love was supposed to be. So we ended up separating. And it's funny that people say, you know, she'd be really beautiful if, or she'd have a really pretty face if. I've never heard that. No one's ever been like, he'd be really hot if. But people said he has a really beautiful personality, or he's really beautiful on the inside if he would just be honest, if he would just live truly or authentically. Those are the things that I would hear. And so when I thought about talking about weight loss, because that's the first, you know, I am kind of stupid and slow to the party. I'm like, oh, I didn't understand the assignment. I was going to talk about weight loss, but then I started thinking about all the times in my life that I heard he'd just be so much more beautiful if he'd just be honest with himself. Not that I allow people to define my sexuality or call those terms, but they saw the struggle. I was very open. I was transparent about struggle and coming to terms with who I was as a person, that they could see that I wasn't living authentically. And so that kind of transitioned, you know, when we got divorced shortly after that, and she repartnered. She met a man who is a great man for her. He's amazing. He's great for my daughter. I did come out, and I remember telling my parents, you know, who really determined a lot of how I lived my life because I was so afraid of upsetting everyone. I finally got to the point where I said, you know, I only have one life to live, and at the end of it, it was mine to do. And I need to make sure that I'm happy with the results. At that point, I was 500 pounds. And I said, you know, I need to make sure that I am here for my daughter and I'm around for her for the, you know, as long as I can be for her life, because she's such a beautiful soul. So I did decide to have weight loss surgery, and I've gotten a lot of backlash. I've gotten a lot of people that have said you took the easy way out.
Wait, why would you do backlash over a surgery? That doesn't make sense.
I think a lot of people, and well, it's always funny because it's always the overweight people that have been like, oh, you took the easy way out. You're a coward. Like, you didn't put in the work, whatever. I mean, I've heard every negative thing on the face of the planet. But it's always somebody that's in shape or health conscious or whatever that is like, good for you. But, and that didn't bother me. I was just like, I know that I've tried. I know that I've worked, but I also know that I'm on a time crunch here. You know, being 32 years old and 500 pounds, I had resting oxygen rates of 78 with a giant oxygen tank that I had to wear around the house at 32 years old.
Oh, wow.
I was probably spending $5,000 a year in emergency medical bills for whatever. I was having, God, I felt like 1 to 2 surgeries a year. It was just, my life was deteriorating and I had to make a change. And so I did that. And it just drastically changed my life. I've gotten to the point to where I'm not nearly where I want to be, but I'm very happy when I look in the mirror, which is actually the first time. It's funny that I just said that. Here I am now approaching 40, and I've had the surgery for a few years. It's the first time that I look in the mirror and I don't see a 500-pound self. And I think I have carried that dysmorphia that's slowly starting to disappear a little bit. But for the longest time, I would look in the mirror and I would see a 500-pound person looking right back at me, even though I went from a size 60-inch waist down to a 36. I couldn't see past that. So,
Ursula, you're going to be surprised, but I actually take care of a lot of kind of like twinkie looking guys that used to be heavy set, and they, when they come to me at the, you know, Crew Health at our office to get their needs addressed, one of the things that they tell me is like, you know, I still see myself in the mirror as a fat guy.
Yeah.
And I'm, you know what, I'm very happy that you shared this, because the reality is that it does take a lot of time for us to separate what we see in the mirror and what we see in here. And yeah. I'm happy that you're able to see that, because some people go a lifetime without being able, they always see themselves as the fat guy in the mirror, even though their actual physical self is not that.
Right.
So.
Well, mine still is. But
really quick. So Alex Sanchez says, Jesus loves you, man. He wants to heal you guys. So Alex, if you're coming in here in a derogatory way, I'm going to ask that you please leave. If you're coming in here saying that he loves us and he just wants to heal us of any type of like you know, weight surgery or addiction or depression. Thank you very much for that, because I believe in God and Jesus as well. And I believe that he will provide what I need when I need it. But if you are coming in here as a derogatory way, I'm going to ask that you please leave. Thank you.
Can I say something about that?
Yeah.
Growing up, you know, a lot of what has determined my view of myself and really made a lot of helped me make the decisions that I've made in my life have been a lot of spiritual and religious persecution that I've gotten from friends, family, I shouldn't even say friends, from people in my life, influences. And, you know, for a long time, I really went through life hating people of faith because I was like, I feel like you robbed me because you oppressed me for so long that I couldn't live authentically. And I've gotten to a point, and I don't know why I'm getting on this tangent, but just because of what you were saying, I've really gotten to a point where I can meet those people with empathy and I really wish the best for them. I really respect people of every walk of faith, whether or not it's Christian, Mormon, whatever. My husband is ex-Mormon, served a mission. Like it's just beautiful. I think that faith is a necessity in life, regardless of what facet you put it on. So when people come that way, or, you know, and I get it a lot, you know, especially being a working queen downtown, walking out of the bar, I'm down there every weekend and people are like, Jesus can save you, handing me pamphlets. I've really learned to really empathize with them and just meet them with love and grace and just be like, you know what, I really thank you for your prayers, whatever. I really hope that you find what you need in your heart, because I'm really happy with where I'm at today.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting because I actually come from a different point of view when those things happen. As a gay individual, right, we are always in places where there's a lot of religious individuals. For whatever reason, they tend to flock to us. It must be the love they have for us inside their hearts.
They go ahead and block him just because he started having some discussion that we don't need to have in here, because this is about positivity, not about negativity.
Exactly.
Right.
But also, you know, the interesting part is I actually feel I feel bad for certain individuals because there's a certain narrow-mindedness that I cannot see all of God's children in all varieties of colors, shapes, and sizes, and beliefs and styles. It's like, how could you not? I mean, you're the one trying to preach this, but you can't see beyond that?
Hello.
I guess I should clarify, those that are meeting with hate, obviously I've got room for blocking. I'm like,
right.
When you're coming at me with hatred, whatever. But if somebody's coming at me with faith and they say, this is my belief, whatever, okay, great, agree to disagree. Thanks for your prayers, but...
Hey, everyone, on Sass and Science, you heard it here first from Eartha Quake, no hate.
No hate. So I have a little couple questions for you. So tell me, when you had your elective, I'm not going to say it was elective because you actually needed it for health. When you had your surgery, did it improve your sex life? Oh, and she three went blank. She was like, nope,
I'm here.
Okay, she's
can
back.
You hear me?
So and you're back. We see you. All like, I asked that question, all of a sudden your screen went completely 100% black.
Where is my audio?
We can hear you. We can hear you.
Yourself. There you
we
go.
Hear you. We hear
Hello.
You.
There you go.
Can
we're
you good.
Okay, wait 1 second.
Can you hear us?
How about now?
We can hear you.
You guys can hear me, but I can't hear you. That's really...
You want to what? Really you want to remove yourself and bring yourself...
I can mimic back to you what you're doing.
Okay, hold on. I'm gonna remove...
Is there a chat?
I'm gonna...
Do you want me to leave the room and come back in?
Sounds good. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, that worked for Chi-Chi.
Yeah.
That was so perfect.
Okay, that was Sass House Down, honey. That was Sass House Down. I was like, did your sex life improve? And she's like, bye, girl.
Wow. Oh, man.
Oh, my God. That was amazing.
That was amazing. Too good.
That was absolutely amazing. And you know what I love? So, Eric, you can't see this, but on my side, I can see that JC is still in the green room. She did not leave us. She's still sitting here, and she is steady watching us. And she's just like, I can see her because you can't see her, but I can see her. She's like, yes. And she's dying laughing. That was everything. So I need to say hello to a couple people that have entered. So Russell Kinzer, Michael Barry, Boriga, Tim Williams, Colton Wall. Hello, hello, hello. Julius Vaughn. Absolutely love Julius. Aaron Morency, Thomas, you've been in here. Brett Bruyan, Hilton Rahim, Daniel Vasquez. Love Daniel Vasquez. If you have never met Daniel Vasquez, that is definitely somebody that you need to meet. Barbara Koa. We love me some Barbara Koa, honey.
I love Barbara Koa.
Everything. I love it. I love it mixed with rice and my guacamole. And hey, girl.
Hi. I got a phone call.
Hello, Ron Baldwin. Hello, Jamie Grumps. Hello, who else is in here? Mark Owen. Hello.
Let me catch you up. Let me talk about
Barbacoa. Barbacoa.
Kingley. Hello, everybody. Hello, hello, hello. So, all right. So now that you're back, so my question was before you were like, bye, girl. Bye.
I'm out.
So tell me this. So did when you had your surgery, did your sex life improve? If it disconnects again.
Can I just say? I think, okay, before surgery, honestly, over a 6-year period, I maybe had sex like 4 or 5 times. I'm not even kidding. Wow. My confidence improved, which improved my libido. Like I mean, I heard you ask somebody earlier. I think you were asking Chi-Chi, like, did the size of your tool improve?
Right.
So I never have, this is going to sound really pretentious and like, oh God, I'm so amazing. But like, nobody really complained about it before when I was fat.
Okay.
But once I lost 244 pounds, like people were like setting up shrines. They were like, let's light a candle. So.
Talking about shrines, too bad I didn't keep Alex in this room. He would have been happy to hear that.
He would have been very happy. I would have been like, you know, let's have a religious moment.
Exactly.
Let's get real.
Exactly.
But, you know, that's a very good question because now I'm with a partner where when that confidence changes and I'm more confident in my own body, I mean, I went from 4 to 6 times over the course of 6 years to like 4 to 6 times a day where I'm like, okay, I want to do it again. Let's do it again. Let's do it again. Like,
that sounds great and tiring at the same time.
You know, I mean, I love it. Now, I almost blushed right through this 4 pounds of makeup.
So listen, I'm going to tell you right now because you said you're approaching 40. I'm 41. And so if you have not followed the shows, we had a show last week called About All About That D, which is vitamin D, which is extremely important for the libido. But it is best to get it from veggies versus going medication-wise.
Sunlight is our best way. But I don't know how the sunlight is in Idaho compared to Florida.
We're actually pretty sunny out. Like, it's, you know what? Idaho's a desert.
Is it really?
Yeah. Yeah, we're kind of a desert area out here. So there's a lot of sun. It gets really hot. I mean, it's not Arizona hot, but.
Right.
Thank God. I'm like kicking back. I'm just like, yeah.
You're like, yeah, man. Yeah, getting that D. You're like, okay, so.
I'm going to get that D.
So I have a question. Oh, she's about it.
Wait, what D are we talking about? I don't get it.
So I have another SASS question for you.
I love it.
So when you had your surgery, so we know that you went, you know, from 4 to 6 times over a year, whatever, to 4 to 6 times a day. Did you find that your erection stays longer or harder?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Like, you know, I thought, well, I mean, yeah, at like 32 years old, I would have to be medicated in order to like, and honestly, and people are going to hear this and they're going to be like, oh, it's because you were with a woman. But I was fortunate enough to be able to perform with my wife. But even after my wife and when I was having sex at my heaviest, I had to plan it out. I had to be like, okay, if I'm going on a date tonight, man, or if I was with my wife, I was like, okay, there's a good chance that we could have sex, so I'm going to have to take a Cialis. I'm going to have to take a Viagra and hope to God that it works and that I'm not humiliated by the end of the evening and that it, that everything worked okay.
You know, it's the funny thing, all that stress you're describing, all that anxiety will just like...
Oh, yeah. Well, and I think, you know, there was a big part, you know, I was... Well, I still am a smoker now, but at the time I wasn't. When I'm not smoking, and I think you'll know this is a... Well, I don't need to talk to you. You went to medical school, but whatever. But even as a smoker, like, when I'm going through long periods of time where I don't smoke, I'd be like, oh my God, my erections are just perfect. And when they're not, I'm like, oh God, it was an 8 out of 10. Let's just say.
Yeah. Well,
but yes, absolutely. I had to be medicated.
So thank you so much.
Did I get off track?
No. Yeah, actually, that's part of our topic.
Part
of our everything on here.
Yeah, everything. So, but no, thank you so much for having us on.
You know what? Anytime you want to join my show, come on.
I would love that. We should schedule a visit.
We should do a road trip up to Boise, Eric, and mm-hmm. and that would be fun. That
right, would be fun. There, one
this year, it's very hard.
Oh, listen, I fly too, but if we're going to do this whole drag thing, if you have not watched that show, We Are Here on HBO, we are so getting a friggin', what's that called, an RV, and we are decking her out, and we are doing a full-on We Are Here, Priscilla, Queen of the Desert.
I was waiting for Priscilla.
Side note, did you see the one where they came to Twin Falls, Idaho?
No, we need to catch
that. This is just last week that premiered We Are Here.
Yeah, we're here. They were in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania.
Okay, maybe it was the week before. They went to Twin Falls.
So we got to go.
Anyway, that's about 2 hours from here, and we had some local queens that were in it. It was they're super important because they were in it, whatever, but I wasn't involved.
Michelle says she thinks that you need to do casseroles.
Do what?
Casseroles.
Oh, I'm Mr. Billy.
Next week, we're thinking about doing David Hasselhoff potatoes, which should really be Hasselback potatoes, but I didn't understand it.
And that's delicious.
And that's delicious. Well, honey, you go do your filming of Cooking with Eartha.
I'm excited
to see what you're going to be whipping up your jello shots this week in your simple hair, your simple gown with your simple jewelry.
Very easy.
Yes, very easy. And
I love you guys. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much for joining us and sharing your story with us. That's amazing. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Eartha.
Thank you. Bye, darling. You know, this was just a stunning, stunning, stunning amount of people that we had on here. I know that today is a very long one. It's an hour and 37 minutes we've been going.
Oh, my God.
And, I want to know, is Jeremy still in here? What's his name? Jeremy?
I don't see a Jeremy.
Was it Jeremy? Who was asking about Bearded Queens? It was Jeremy.
Oh, yeah, it was Jeremy. Jeremy Wheat.
Jeremy Wheat, are you still in here? Because I would like to have that discussion with you about...
Ooh, you got Beyonce directly having that conversation.
You got me right here, honey. So if you got a question about it, I got an answer for you. Because I...
He responded again the second time after we, I think one of our visitors or guest stars actually clarified a little bit. And it's interesting because in his second response, he says that the only time he noticed that there are bearded queens was in Texas. And I'm wondering, is that a Southern, did it start off like a Southern?
No, the Southern states are actually extremely strong pageant-wise.
Right.
They are about female illusion. He probably saw the one, it was another bearded competition that happened in Texas. Mm-hmm. They had a prelim happening over there. So he may have seen it on that. But with me being the National Bearded Empress Emeritus, Pense, this is a subject that I love to dive into. And the thing about it is it's not for everybody, but there's an explanation behind it. So if any of you want to know the explanation, give us a bunch of hearts right now, because I will go ahead and I will give you the explanation behind the aesthetic of bearded drag. Excuse me, give us a bunch of hearts. I'm watching the screen. Hello, Jay Miha. Give us a bunch of hearts and I will explain it. If not, you guys can always just send me a message and I can always also give you a bunch of information. So we see a bunch of hearts going on right now. All right, so bearded drag. What is it? Why is it? Blah, 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 blah. So I want to reverse. I'm actually going to go back to what Shishi LaRue said earlier. And she said that back in her day, it was called hag drag or skag drag. Skag drag was because at the time of Stonewall, JC says, thank you both. You are very, very welcome, JC. You are very, very welcome. At the time of Stonewall, you know, it was illegal to be gay. It was illegal to do female impersonation. It was illegal to do drag. It was illegal to do engage in any type of homosexuality at all.
Now we're talking about the New York Stonewall, right?
Correct. Correct. So, I'm putting it in that time. In that time, you know, nationwide, worldwide, whatever. So people that wanted to entertain would actually do drag, but they would leave their masculine features. The reason why was because if there was a raid that happened, they could quickly get out of drag and become their gender without the persecution. They were already going to get persecuted for being homosexual or part of the LGBTQ community at that time. But to put drag on top of that, they were going to get persecuted again.
So it was like a lesser, I don't want to call it a lesser crime, but is that kind of?
It was a lesser crime. It was kind of like one of those things where they were speeding, but they weren't recklessly driving.
Okay.
Okay. So now let's fast forward into this day and age. After all of the fighting, all of the rights that we have done, after we have gone and we have, you know, been fighting for transgender rights, for racial inclusivity, for the rights of every single human being out there being treated as equal. What are we, 2020? So 8 years ago, when I started drag, I started my first 3 performances non-bearded. My first 3 performances, and then I was done. And then I was like, oh no, I need my beard back because I can't look at myself in the mirror. So I brought a beard on. And the reason why I brought my beard on was because this is my identity. This is who I am. I am a bear within our community. So why am I going to transform the way I look to entertain? I'm not doing female illusion. I'm not doing, I'm not trying to portray myself as a woman or a female impersonator or a transgender woman at all. I am coming out as an entertainer. An entertainer for you to look at me and for me to entertain you and you be entertained by what I am delivering and not that I have a beard. My beard is an extension of me and it is beautiful. Granted, it's gray underneath all of this black because I fill it in because I am 41 years old and I haven't colored it, but it is an extension of me. And that is what basically Bearded Drag is about stopping the binary and making it the non-binary. It's making it to where, why are we saying you have to look this certain way to fit into a certain mold when molds are made to be broken and there is no mold that should be even casted because everybody is individual. And that is what we were talking about today. That is what we talked about. We talked about they have a pretty face, but, and I was told that when I first started doing drag was, you know, if you want to be taken seriously, you have to shave. If you want to go anywhere, you have to shave. And I'm like, but I don't want to. Why? Why? And let me tell you, when I walked out with wads of cash in my hands, walking by somebody else that had shaved and they had a couple bucks, there's a reason. And it's because times have changed. And it is not putting a disrespect to the ancestors of the drag community. It is not mocking the drag community. It is the representation of a different day. You know, I will be the first to say, somebody that identifies as male, that then goes and identifies as female illusionist, I give them 100% props down.
Because absolutely. I mean, talk about transcendence. That's the definition and epitome of it.
Going in and contouring and cutting and highlighting and literally reconstructing your face without plastic surgery, with makeup application, and creating an illusion of female identity is hard.
Well, I mean, I could do a few injections here and there to create a shape, but
you know. Exactly. You know, and so people that have that, bravo, like fantastic. I would never say that. They are the ones that built the pillars for all types of drag today. Bio queens, drag kings, monster entertainers, bearded entertainers. It is all about the form of art within the drag community. It is not about a female illusion anymore. Today's drag has been, and I'm not knocking the show whatsoever, and you know what show I'm talking about, has been misguided because of the only type of representation that that show has. They have some monster-ish, quirky, you know.
Which, but that's also limited on that show. I don't see a lot of those.
It's very, very, very limited. You know, and then we have other shows, like a couple that are started on YouTube and one's now on Amazon Prime and all of the other things, that are showing the different aspects of the art of drag. Drag is about a transformation. It is about taking and moving your way into an entertainment field and applying things, whether it's a cone to your head or your shoulders or putting on a face, you know, and a wig. It's
look all Lady Gaga. My favorite outfit of hers was the bubbles, where she was nothing but a ball of bubbles.
Nothing but a ball of bubbles. You know what I mean? And even and that even too. I mean, if you look at that in the sense of, I love that because it proved, like Angina, and even one of our contestants with National Bearded Empress, Lennon Dumour, they are bald queens. Mm-hmm. They represent the bald community. And they are showing, look, you don't have to have a wig, you know, like this, which I've got to say I absolutely love, which by Roberto Gonzalez. You know, you don't have to have a wig to have art, because that is what drag is about. Is about art. So instead of looking at that person and going, you know, you're really pretty, but you should shave, or you're really pretty, you should put on a wig. Know their story before you give them a buck.
Hey, they're on saying.
Right of hour 46 minutes.
You know, you're really pretty, but it's been an hour and 46 minutes.
Yeah, so we're gonna go. You know what? I know Julius was in here, and we actually have he had sponsored a gift, but I'm gonna save that for next week's.
Yeah, absolutely. And hopefully we can get something from Gay Days. Let's see if they
exactly
up from the show.
Because this was such a serious sassy, it was more on the side of sass. Topic today that I think that like I just don't want to make up something just to give it away. You know, but definitely follow fatmarkerclothing.com so that
truehealth.org
and oh well girl I'm getting there if you give me a minute. fatmarkerclothing.com has amazing wares. They have everything you need. They even have masks. They even have masks right now. Yes. And then always make sure that your health provider is the one and the only Mr. Eric Suarez, APRN, FNP-BC/AA-HIV-M. I'm sorry?
That's a lot of letters in one mouth.
That is a lot of letters. That is a lot of letters. And why is that not showing up? Oh, because I upload as a background. Of crewhealth.org. Because honestly, teleservices today are extremely important, and making sure that you guys stay healthy during this crisis is fantastic. For any of our
continuation of your medications, right? That is completely critical, because that means I stay stable at home versus I have to have an emergency to go to the ER where now I can get infected with COVID. So even the simplest thing of staying home, and that's where telemedicine really shows its true value.
Correct. Correct. It really, 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 really does. So I would just like to say thank you so much for everything that you do for the community, Eric, and to all of our other essential medical team, everything from medical to the police department, to all of our essential workers, the grocery workers, everything. Thank you so much for your dedication to keeping your services available while we are sitting here bitching and complaining that we're stuck at home. So thank you so much. This is Beyonce Bear, the SASS.
And Eric Suarez, the science
of Sass and Science. We will see you. We are having a day and time change. We are actually moving to Mondays. Is it 7 or 7:30?
7 o'clock, yeah.
So we are moving to Mondays at 7 p.m. because in the event that I do have to go back to work, I work late on Thursdays, so I would not be able to be available, but I will be available on Mondays because I'm off. So please join us on Monday. Our next subject is all about female anatomy and the female love for one another, because what's real? Let's be honest. All right. Thank you so much for joining us today. I apologize that it was long, but these are subjects that definitely need to be talked about. I would like to say a huge thank you to Shishi LaRue, Christina Gariba, JC Ray, and Luke Jarman. Again, Beyonce Bear of the SASS of the Science, and this is
SASS and Science.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.